Welcome back to the KDPG Sunday Edition. This morning, we are discussing what has happened with Congressman Tim Murphy, but also on a more broader perspective, a new book written by Jason Altmaier called Dead Center, How Political Polarization Divided America and What We Can Do About It. John Delano, of course, also our political editor, served in Washington, D.C. for an extended period of time, 14 years, as the chief aide to then-Congressman Doug Walgren. Jason, I want to start with this something. The introduction in your book goes, on the morning of Sunday, June the 12th, 2016, Americans woke up to the horrific news of a deranged gunman had opened fire in a crowded Orlando nightclub, killing 49 people, wounding 68 others. You penned that before this past weekend's instance. Not much has changed since you penned this less than a year ago.
I spent about 2 years researching and writing the book, and I wasn't quite sure where I was going to go with it until the Pulse shooting in Orlando, which I live in Florida now, and the two sides of America that were on display in the immediate aftermath is what struck me and what touched me and clarified what I want to talk about in the book. And that's, you had people coming out and giving blood and donating money and holding vigils all around the country. You saw the best of America, but then you also saw the worst of America. If you go back and you read the social media post and see what the political community was saying back and forth, casting blame, pointing fingers, trying to get political advantage over this horrific tragedy that we had just had, those are two diametric opposites. And that really is the microcosm of America itself with our political. And that's what I talk about with the divide in the country. We should have our political system run and dominated by the people who are the good side of America. But unfortunately, because of the way we structure our political system, often the extremes are who determines the outcome of elections. And I think the aftermath of the Pulse shooting is the perfect example of those two sides.
And unfortunately, it's still going on to this moment.
That
we have the two sides, extremes. Now, you mentioned the word extremes. Can we delve into that a little bit?
Yes.
Because I think it's your contention that most of America is either a little right of center or just a little left of center, but not very far.
That's the message, right.
But they're not really running the country.
That's exactly the point of the book. It is a misconception that the nation is polarized, that America has never been more polarized. That is not true. Most Americans want to know who the Steelers are going to play on Sunday. They want to know who, what activities their kid has tonight. What's my work schedule look like next week? That's what most folks are thinking about. And when they think about Congress, they want Congress to get along, to compromise, to get things done. But the political activists, they're on the fringe. They're on the extreme. They work on campaigns. They give money. They show up at town halls. They call your office. And when it's that group of people that an elected official has to appeal to message to that group to get elected, you're going to have a very different set of circumstances in Congress than if the other group was more politically active.
Jason, can I, Stacey, if I can jump in?
Sure.
I want to ask Jason this to tell this mm-hmm. story, because I thought it was so telling how you held a town meeting.
On the sidewalk outside of a store,
right?
Right. Yeah.
And you had both a Republican and a Democrat come to you and accuse you of being with one side or the other. Tell the story.
Well, this is the opening of the book after the Pulse introduction, and I was new in Congress. I'd been in office about 4 months, and I was in Allison Park, and it was a Congress on Your Corner event. So there were about 24 people standing on the sidewalk outside of a Shop and Save. And the first question was from a Democrat. I was a Democrat in office. And he was very disappointed in me, talking about in 4 months all the things I had done to offend him. And he used the term, "You're really just the Republican." And when he said that, another woman in this small group of 24 people shrieked and said, "What are you talking about? Everybody knows he's just a pawn for Nancy Pelosi." And they turned towards each other and started to have a heated argument with each other, arguing over whether I was a liberal or a conservative,
and
with
you,
me standing right there.
And you chose not to get involved.
I stepped back and let him go
at it.
But did you take that as a source of pride that you were in the middle?
I take it as a compliment. It's like a sports announcer when both sides think they're biased towards their team. That means they're doing a pretty good job.
But the other part I found interesting is you also stated that you had come to realize that the opposition was going to have a camera there to record, and it's going on today,
right,
what you said, to try to use it against you at some point. But then you also realized there was another camera there from your own party.
Right. Yeah, there were two. Again, a small group of 24 people. And over time, I got used to this. But early in my career, it was, kind of striking. So the first person puts up a video camera, and you assume, from my perspective, it's a Republican, and they're getting ready for the next election. Then a second camera goes up in this small group, and I could tell by their reactions to what I was saying, you know, the way they would nod, that one was a Republican and one was a Democrat. And they were both filming me to prove that I was disloyal to their side. So again, that's how I knew I was right in the middle.
That leads me then back to the whole extremism issue here, and that is that if you are in the middle, which you tried to be, can you win these days at all?
You can't win in the current circumstance. That's what the book is about, and I offer, my last chapter is recommendations on how we can break free from that. And to cut to the chase on that, the answer is you have to structure primaries in a way that the candidates have to appeal to a much wider swath of the American ideological electorate. So right now in a primary, if the only folks who show up are on the extremes of both parties, guess who's going to win? And guess who you're going to be presented with in the general election as your two candidates? But if you do like California has done and you go to open primaries where both Republicans and Democrats and Green parties and Libertarians and everybody else are in the same primary, you have to have a very different message to get through that primary. It's basically a general election message. So if you go in and you only appeal to the extremes, you're not going to be successful.
Where do you come down on gerrymandering as a poison in the system? You know, gerrymandering has always been with us, but it's at an extreme.
Well, I lost my seat in large part to gerrymandering. So when I started writing the book, I thought this is the problem, like everyone thinks that. But what you find when you write a book like this is all of those things, partisan media and gerrymandering and the sorting of Americans that you hear about as causes, they're not causes, they're symptoms. Mm. And gerrymandering is actually not as much of the source of the problem. Really, it's that open primary, and it's the fact that we need to get more people to vote.
Are you saying the open primary is a fixable problem, where gerrymandering, we're stuck with it like a
Well, tattoo? You could move to commissions. Right now, when you have politicians running the process, you have elected officials choosing their voters rather than the voters choosing their leaders. That's not what the Founding Fathers had in mind. So we need to change it for fairness, but it doesn't solve the problem.
John, I want to bring you in on just a second. When your time and when you were in Congress, did you see the same kind of extremism?
Did not. There was extremist views, of course, represented by different individuals in the Congress. But this was an era in which at least if you held a certain view, you would still talk to the other side and cut a deal. I mean, this was the time when Speaker Tip O'Neill and President Ronald Reagan would cut all kinds of deals on immigration reform, on taxes, on tax cuts, for example, Social Security. All of these, some big governmental issues, were resolved basically because the Democratic leadership and the Republican leadership were willing to talk and cut a deal, cut a compromise. My impression today, and of course I'm not down there anymore, but Jason, you're the expert on this, my impression today is that it's much harder, because of the extremes, to cut a moderate deal between the parties. Is that your observation?
Well, it's much harder because the centrists have been removed from the equation.
Well, that's true, too. There are very few centrist members of Congress anymore, right?
You can't build bridges if you eliminate the bridge builders, and that's what's happened.
But I don't want to get in, because I think you touch on this in the book, and that is that while we're talking about the extremes in the hinterlands, where your constituencies are, that they're the ones who go to the primaries, but the extremes within your own party inside Congress can also drive you out.
That's exactly what the Democrats have done. The Democrats have, for the most part, purged the centrists from their caucus in Congress. The debate that's happening on the Republican side in the House, that was won by the far left on the Democratic side. They're still having it at the national level, but in the House, the Republicans still have two factions. The Democrats don't.
You were, maybe, and still are, I assume, a pro-life, pro-gun Democrat.
In Western Pennsylvania, if you want to win in that type of moderate district, like Mark Critz, Jack Murtha, folks like that, I believe Frank Mascara was that way. That's the type of Democrat, if you want to be successful, that you have to field to win.
And if the Democratic Party doesn't welcome you, and the extremes say, no, you can't be pro-life in the Democratic Party, or you can't be in favor of Second Amendment rights in the Democratic Party, then you're condemning this area, frankly, to all Republican rule.
And you're condemning the party to the minority in the Congress, because you're not going to be able to win a majority of seats.
How did you get along with Nancy Pelosi?
Very well. She became frustrated with me when she realized that there was really nothing she could say to me that was going to change my mind once my district's voice was known. So I do tell some anecdotes about our relationship. I mean, she understood the type of district, but she made a decision that she was going to use her time in power to do some big and bold things, which she did, and more power to her. But the result was the Democrats got wiped out of power and lost all of these swing seats that are now held not just by Republicans, but in many cases, far-right Republicans.
Have you seen the phenomenon of people who start off extreme, but then they spend some time in Washington and their rough edges get worn off? I mean, all those people who came in to the Tea Party is like, well, term limits. Many of them are still there saying, well, what we need to do is come to a, you know.
Well, I don't know if their ideology changes, but they realize to be successful in the system, as a legislator, you have to change your ways.
Looking, we only have about 30 seconds to go. Looking back, what would you say was the thing you were most proud of while you served in Congress?
My work for veterans, I have 9 laws with my name on it dealing with veterans, is, I would say, legislatively, but I talk in the book, I have a whole half chapter on the Haiti orphan rescue mission. I would say that is as far as memorable experiences, that's probably the most memorable experience in my life.
And again, the book is called Dead Center, and the reason it's called Dead Center is because?
I was rated exactly in the midpoint of the House by National Journal's vote rankings. 217 members to my left, 217 to my right.
Right.
Hope it doesn't mean the center is dead, though.
Well, that's the point of the book. That's what we're talking about.
All right. If you want to read a fascinating book, I suggest you do pick up Dead Center, How Political Polarization Divided America and What We Can Do About It. A lot of great little stories in here also, such as in 2008 and when you were being urged as a superdelegate to either go with now then President Obama, soon to be President Obama, or Hillary Clinton in her campaign against him. It's a fascinating book. John Allison and I will be back with some final thoughts in just a moment.